Welcome everybody. My name is Mehmet Fatih Karagoz, and today with my colleague Cevahir, we will introduce you a new software framework, Node, and how we can use this framework on embedded Linux devices. Let's start with our agenda. We will start with some brief information about this framework, Node, its advantages and disadvantages. Then we will move to our second section, how we can cross-compile Node for embedded Linux devices and it's also package manager. Then we will have a look at the development environment. And on my final part, I will show you some scripting samples that can be usable on embedded devices. Then I will give word to my friend and he will tell the development story of our surveillance application. Okay, let's start with some brief information about this framework. Let's start, what is Node? This is the official website definition from Node's website. We see that Node is a platform that's built on Google's V8 JavaScript runtime, and it's for building fast, scalable network applications. And its main features are, it's firstly event-driven. It uses an event queue instead of a multi-threaded approach. And the second one, it uses a non-blocking I/O model, which enforces us to use an asynchronous programming model, and none of Node's internal functions doing blocking I/O. And it's lightweight, it's around 5 megabyte file size in binaries, and it uses about 15 megabytes RAM usage on our sample application, which we will show in demo. And its efficient hardware usage enables us to use it on embedded systems too. Like all frameworks, Node also has some advantages and some disadvantages. When we look at the advantages, we see that it's open source, so you don't have to pay for any license fees. As we said previously, its hardware efficiency enables it to use it on embedded systems too. It has a fast learning curve, and I will explain in the next slide. The development time is very short, especially on network applications when you are doing lots of I/O compared to C or C++, and we experienced it in our prototype surveillance application too. And the language is JavaScript. It's JIT compiled, just-in-time compiled language. So it's easy to learn it with respect to C++ or C languages, and you don't need to compile any code, so you can fix some bugs immediately and you don't have to create new binaries and push them to your devices. Also, the package manager is also very nice. You can find many modules for lots of different purposes, and it's very easy to install them with just single line of command. When we look at the disadvantages, we see that it's a new framework, so it has a small developer pool. It can be hard to find local expert guys, but it's an active and growing community. It has very good community, so you can find help on internet. Also, it's bad at CPU-bound jobs. When you do CPU-intensive coding, you block all the event queue, and when you do blocking I/O, you block also all the event queue, so you should be very careful when programming, keeping in mind that you you're doing asynchronous programming. And finally, its asynchronous debugging is also hard. With respect to synchronous debugging, it's hard to trace the memory and finding memory leaks. And next, we look at the learning curve. Node use JavaScript. It's a comparably easy language to learn, and if you know programming, you can adapt to it very easily. And most of the web developers are already familiar with the language, so this is a plus in my idea. When you are following the tutorials on internet, you can start building your basic applications, I think, in less than an hour, and it also includes the installation time too. Okay, when we look at the package manager, its name is npm, Node Package Modules. It installs modules very easily, and it also works on embedded systems too. As you can see, just with one line of command, npm install express, we are installing the express module. It's a module for RESTful web applications. And it also installs dependent modules too, so you don't have to worry about them, and it has a global install option. So if you have many applications using Node and you have common modules, you can install them globally and you don't have to install for each of them. And these are some examples of the popular modules on npm website. Here we used Express for our RESTful web server, and Socket.io we used for web client and server WebSocket communication. And also you can find much more on npm. These are just examples. We just mentioned some brief information about Node. And in this part, I will explain you how we can cross-compile Node and its package manager, npm. Okay, firstly, the official address of Node is node.js.org, and you can get the tarballs from /download address. Also, you can use Git to get the code. Also, its license is MIT license, which is, I think, quite flexible, so you can do changes. We built Node using classic /configure and make install, but when we do it on embedded systems, there are some important configuration options that we must choose carefully. Our first option is without npm option. If you select this option, you don't get the npm package built with it. And our second option is SSL option. Normally, Node comes OpenSSL built with it, but if you don't want SSL support on Node, you can choose this option. Without SSL option is important because if you want to use npm, you must have SSL support because npm uses SSL for downloading modules from internet. And our third option is without snapshot option. We can't have snapshot views when we are cross-compiling. So if you want to have snapshots on your embedded system, you either build Node on your target or use an emulator system and build on it. And what we lose without snapshots, the handicap is the starting time of Node instance. The V8 instance initialization time is shortened with the snapshot support, but when we don't have it, we will wait around 1-2 seconds, I think, when we are just initializing the node. And the other options, I think, are clear. The CPU and the OS options, which are, for our case, ARM and Linux. After deciding our configuration options, now we export our cross-compile binaries, and then we do configure with our options, and we make and make install. I personally extract them to a folder, and then copy them to my embedded device. And then after these steps, I think we are ready to do to execute the node on our target. Okay, let's look at the development environment. Actually, you can use any editor which supports JavaScript because it's not a compiled language, but some editors have some pluses. I personally use Gedit when I'm working on Ubuntu, and I'm using WebStorm working on Mac. The WebStorm has nice features such as code completion and some debugging support also. Also, you have a bunch of options. These are just examples. For example, Cloud9 is cloud-based editor. You can use traditional IDEs such as Eclipse, and it also has a plugin. So you have many options, and you can decide whichever you are comfortable. Node also have internal debug options too, and you start your Node script using Node debug myscript.js example. And you are in debug mode, and you have some options here like setting and clearing breakpoints, or setting watchers, or look at the variable values on runtime. And some IDEs like WebStorm already have an interface for it if you don't want to do it on console. But personally, I not used debugging in detail. The console logs were enough for me on my experiences. Okay, we now have the infrastructure for developing Node, and where can we use it? We can use it for scripting samples that can be used instead of Bash maybe. And we have a development story which my friend Javair will explain in detail. Now I will show you some scripting samples that we can use by Node. Our first sample is let on off function. Here we use the exec function of the child process module of Node, and here we have a function set let on, and it sets the let's value to on, and here we use exec and make a system call to the let's brightness. We print an echo one. This is an asynchronous function, and when this system call is completed, it goes to this function, which is a callback function, and it prints this string to the console. Also, you can, of course, set echo to zero, so you will have a let off function too. Actually, with this function, you can write your own factory applications too, can execute any binary, and you can trace their status, and you can relaunch them maybe when they die. And second example is the CPU memory usage application. We here use the OS module from the Node's internal modules, and here we have three functions: load average function, free memory function, and total memory function. This one returns us an array of three, which gives 1 minute, 5 minute, and 15 minutes average values of the CPU load, and we print it to console with this command. And in our second example, we get the free memory amount and the total memory amount of the system, and we print them to the console with this. So you can do some memory CPU tracing application using these simple functions. My third example is the timers. I think it's very powerful and easy to implement in JavaScript and Node. Here we are doing a LED blinking application, which makes LED 1 second on and 1 second off, and it goes like this. And here we have this timer function set interval, and this is the timeout value, which is 1 second, and each 1 second it calls this function. This function is defined here, and as you remember, this code is similar to my first example. Here just we change the value every time it goes into function from 0 to 1 and vice versa, so we have a blinking LED example at the output. My last example is an init parser example. Here we parsing a sample in a file such as name with version, etc. And here we use the power of npm. Here we install a init parser module from npm with this line of command. And then we require the init parser such as here. Then we have a function, asynchronous function, parse function. We give the file name, and then when it finished the parsing operation, it goes to the callback function. In the data variable, we will have the values here, such as data.version or data.name. You can reach the values, and if there is an error occurred when doing this job, it will go into the error variable. And if there is no error occurred, it will be a null variable, so you can find if there is an error occurred or not. Now my part is finished, and I will give word to my colleague, and he will explain you the implementation details of our surveillance application. Thank you.
Thank you, Fatih. Welcome again. I'm Cevahir, and I'm going to talk about example surveillance application. The purpose is to demonstrate usage scenario of Node.js in real-world application by giving more information about network class of Node.js to run complete Node.js application in embedded platform. In the example system, there are two parts. The first part is smart IP cameras, which can detect motion. And the second part is server side, which is located at command control center, which monitors cameras, gather their alarms in order to show user. This is the deployment model of example system. We have a server PC at the command control center, and we have fake IP cameras, which are IGAP version 2 embedded ports, and they are all connected to each other through Ethernet. Embedded Linux is running on our fake camera, which is IGAP version 2 ports. We have a custom kernel, which has a version 2.6.37. And then we compiled our Node.js binaries and all other binaries with GCC version 4.6.3. This is the component diagram of our example system. We have, as I mentioned, two parts. Camera side and server PC. There are two software components at embedded side. The first component is fake video application to simulate alarm messages. Video application sends alarm messages to server through TCP server. And then the second part is system manager application, which is written using Node.js. This system manager application takes configuration from server side and sends to video application through inter-process communication, which is TCP connection. And system manager application also sends heartbeat messages to server. Then our server side listens these UDP heartbeat messages to discover online cameras. And then server application can send configuration to online cameras through TCP connection. And our server application serves static HTML5 pages. And these pages are written in AngularJS framework. There is also a socket communication between server application and static HTML files. And this is the overview of our system. It's a little complicated diagram. It just also shows the messages of the system. After this point, I'm going to talk about coding details of each software component. The first one is fake video application. It is fake to simulate motion detection. In real world, it's actually a real video application which can detect motion, or you can do any video-related jobs. It has connection to camera system manager through TCP. This is the example of inter-process communication between Node.js and other binaries, which can be written in different languages. It can also produce periodic alert messages at 10 or 30 seconds, depending on its configuration. This is the code snapshot from the video application. This is just a TCP client to connect camera system manager application, but its code is not shown in here. After TCP connection to system manager application, it creates a new thread to send periodic alarm, and then it tries to read a configuration message from the system manager application. We have two sample configuration message. One can change video source, and the other configuration message can change motion detection mode. We have three options in motion detection. User can turn off the motion detection, or user can turn it by setting alarm period to 10 seconds, or user can change the alarm period to 30 seconds. After taking any configuration message, this application sent acknowledgement message to system manager application. This is all about video application, just to simulate periodic alarm messages by setting its mode. This is the main application to simulate fake video camera. Camera system manager application is written in Node.js, and it manages all other software elements running on camera through inter-process communication. This example system, it takes configuration from server and sends this configuration messages to video application. There are two TCP servers and one UDP client to send hard messages. This is the our first TCP server application at camera system manager site. We use net module of Node.js to use TCP servers and TCP clients. We create a TCP server by calling create server function of net module. As you can see, there is a callback function. I'll talk it later. After creating this TCP server, we start to listen connections from the given port, from the destination address. Whenever a connection is made, this callback function is executed. And when fake video application connects this server, this socket object is created, and then the socket TCP socket object has event listeners. As my friend said, Node doesn't have any training. It runs through event listeners and non-blocking functions. In here, we have data and close event listeners. Whenever a data is taken through this circuit, this data event is emitted and the data is received. We can check the length of data by the data objects length member, and then we can process the taken data as a byte array. As you can see, we check in here opcodes. Fake video application can send acknowledgement messages and alarm messages through this TCP connection. Whenever an alarm is taken from the video application, we can take it and tries to send to TCP connection of the other device, which is TCP connection between server application, which is running at command control center. In here, we create the second TCP server, and then we try to get new connections through the given port. As you can see, the host address is omitted, so all connections, which is directed to any IPv4 address of the host, is taken by this server. As you can see, we have also data and close event listeners. In here, data, when the data is taken from server application, this code tries to send the given configuration message to our video socket, which is a TCP connection between camera system manager and fake video application. And the close event listener is called whenever the connection between server and this application is fully closed. This event listener is emitted also asynchronously. This is the UDP broadcaster to send heartbeat messages to server. We include a datagram module of Node.JS to create UDP objects by calling create socket using UDP4. We can create a UDP client object. After that, we bind a random UDP port in order to send heartbeat messages. In here, this is also a synchronous call. When this client binds a random UDP port, this code is executed, and we set broadcast to true to enable broadcasting. Finally, we create an if timer to send periodic heartbeat messages to server. As you can see, we send status of the camera, device ID, status, location, and video source and video model of the video application, and time. We just send with simple method. We give message, offset of the message, and message length, and giving UDP port and broadcast address. There is also a callback function. In this callback function, bytes is the bytes number that are sent successfully. The error object is the error object, which you can read if there is error. If there is no error, it will be null. Of course, we don't check for the simplicity in here. This is all about our embedded part. Video application and system manager application are running on our IGAP version 2 boards. This camera system manager application takes 15 megabytes from the RAM and nearly a zero CPU power. And the second part of my presentation is a server application, which is running on command control center. This application is connected to all online cameras. It discovers cameras by listening, broadcast other messages of the cameras. It configures cameras over TCP connection, and it listens other messages from camera. Finally, it serves static HTML5 pages to show online cameras and taken alarm messages to user. This is a little complicated code, but actually it's just a function. In this server application, we create an if UDP object from the datagram module, and you can take UDP messages by implementing a message event listener of the UDP object. And this function is called whenever a message is taken from the our UDP port. In here, message is the taken data, and our info is the remote address information of the message source. After message is taken, we just check if the taken message is from the registered camera or it's a newly connected camera. If it is taken from the already registered camera, we just update camera information. If it is a new camera, we just create a new device at the device's object, and then we save the information of the camera to newly created object, and then we get IP address of the message source from the rinfo object, and then we create any TCP client object in here to make connection with the camera system manager application. In here, we try to connect given port and to new camera. And this is also a callback function. When the connection is made through this newly connected device, this function is executed. And then we implement data close and error event listeners of the this new TCP client object. Whenever the data is taken from server, we just take it and send this data to web clients by calling send alarm by socket. Of course, camera can't send can send only alarm messages through this TCP connection. So we just take data, don't control, and send to socket. And whenever a TCP connection is closed, first we send information about disconnected camera to web clients, and then we remove it from the our device list. Server application has also HTTP server, and this is the code of the HTTP server of a server application. In here, it serves static contents, which is located in here, and it makes real-time WebSocket connection to connect to the web clients. We just use Express and Socket.io models from which is taken with NPM package manager. HTTP module is Node.js core module. This is the configuration of Socket.io code, but I'll skip this. WebSocket WebSocket can make us a real-time communication between server application and web clients. It has a connection event listener. We implement this connection event listener to get connection from the web clients. Whenever a web client is connected to our server application, this callback function is executed. In this callback function, we implement a new event listener named getDeviceList and other config event listener. Web client can request list of already connected cameras through this event. And it can request to change a setting of the any camera through config event. When this config event is emitted, this WebSocket sent the configuration parameters of the video application, and then it called send devices conf to send this taken data to our TCP client connection. Then we just save this NIF WebSocket to our WebSocket list. Server application also sends data to web clients. For example, it can send camera info on alarm. We just call emit function of the WebSocket, and we give event name and data. Taken alarm are sent through this function to all connected web clients. This is just functions used at previous slide. There are the other WebSocket functions called by server application to send data to connected web clients. We send data through NivCam, UpdateCam, and DropCam events to web clients. These are the data about these events. Web interface is served by server application. It is written in Socket.io and AngularJS, which is AX-based HTML5 development environment. Actually, this is another story, and I'll skip the details. This is the example usage of Socket.io at web client site. And this example is taken from the website of the Socket.io. It just takes data from these event listeners and send data to web server by calling emit function of the socket. This is the Socket.io call of our web client site. There are two functions, set MD mode and set video source. Web clients can send data to server through these functions. It can change motion detection mode of the camera by calling config and message. There are also event listeners to get data from server, like get device list, camera info, as mentioned previously, new cam, update cam, drop cam, and alarm. Whenever alarm is taken, we just get data of alarm and push this data to alarm list. AngularJS updates with when model is changed. This alarm table is updated at the web browser automatically when we update this list at the model. This is the end of our presentation. Thank you for your patience. Now we'll try to make our demo. Let's start our server application. Can we power off these fake cameras? Actually, this server application can also run on this embedded fake application. It starts to listen new connections from the given port, and then we have our web interface. Okay. Our client is connected, but there is no online cameras. And we will power on these boards. It takes nearly 1 minute to boot up. and our first fake camera is found, and we just show its information in here, its IP, the latest time of the taken message from the UDP port, and camera status, camera's location, and video mode, and video source of the fake video application in here. And there is no alarm in here because motion detection mode is opened in turn off mode. Then we connect the camera. Let's set motion detection mode to one. And we have alarm message, which is taken from the our camera. Mode one. In mode one, camera sends periodic alarms at each 10 seconds. Let's change its motion detection mode to mode two. And it just updated with the new heartbeat message. Let's change video source mode to thermal of device ID bit one. Just change second. In here, it sends alarm messages at every 10 seconds, but with the change of the motion detection mode, it will send heartbeat messages at 30 seconds. It will take a while for the new message. And the new message is taken. Let's change motion detection mode of the third camera. And we have a alarm message from the third camera also in here. You can find the codes of demo from this address. The whole code samples are in here. And thank you for your patience. If you have any questions, we'd like to answer. Okay. Actually, you can get pre-installed modules, but you have to install NPM to at least one camera and take these modules, and you can use the source of the modules at anywhere.
Actually, you offline. Can use the JavaScript-based modules directly copy them to the modules folder and you can use them, but some modules have C++ bindings and they can be some problematic when you copy from your desktop PC to embedded system, so you must build them on your embedded device.
So the only way to ensure it's going to be working fully is to...
If it's completely JavaScript-based, it's no problem, I think, because I did it on my experience and it's no problem. But if you have C++, coming into the game, then you can have some problems.
But you can also compile it at a sample card and then use these binaries at the same configuration. Okay. Yes?
I think at least hundreds of megabytes.
Pardon?
Hundreds of megabytes, I think, at least. It would be problematic, in my opinion. I never tried on these lower memory devices, but The device we are working on here, the iGap has 500 megabytes RAM, and we are using, I think, 300 megabytes for the Linux, and the other part is divided for the DSP part. So we are running on actually 300 megabytes, and we are fine. We are not using much of it. But I think below the 100 megabytes range, you can have some problems, maybe.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Thank you for your participation.
Thank you.